Good afternoon. So in the last class, we have seen the properties of an algorithm and few of the algorithms. And one of the property was efficiency. So we studied something about efficiency. That is, an algorithm must be efficient. Now, how can the efficiency be analyzed? How can the efficiency be analyzed? One measure of efficiency is time, and the other measure is space. Okay, so one measure of efficiency can be time, the other measure can be space. Also, whenever we are talking about these type of problems, then that is known as computational complexity. It is known as computational complexity. And whenever we are speaking about computational complexity, there are two types of that. One is time complexity, and the other is space complexity. Okay, now in this case, how can the efficiency of an algorithm be analyzed? It is used to solve the algorithm when input values are of a specified size. So one is the time, and the second measure is the amount of computer memory, which can also be known as the space required to implement the algorithm when input values are of specified size. Now let's look at the definition of time and space complexity. An analysis of the time required to solve a problem of a particular size. So basically what we are doing is we are trying to measure the time, taken by an algorithm. To process the input, that is the time complexity. Similarly, for space complexity, it is the amount of memory required, amount of space required, if you want to tell it in simple terms. So it is the amount of space required. Now, time complexity is the one which is important whenever we are going for algorithms and trying to measure its efficiency. So the time complexity of an algorithm is expressed in terms of number of operations. So whenever we are speaking about time complexity, we try to express it in terms of number of operations. And used by an algorithm when the input has a particular size. And the operations used to measure the time complexity can be comparison of integers. So suppose if you are comparing integers in sorting or searching techniques, so it can be either comparison of integers or addition of integers, multiplication of integers, and any other basic operation. Even division can be included. Any other basic operation. Time complexity is described in terms of the number of operations required. So time complexity is number of operations required instead of actual computer time. So we don't measure it in milliseconds or seconds or minutes. We measure it in number of operations required. So is it n square operations or 2n operations or log n operations? It is measured in this way, not in terms of seconds or milliseconds or hours. Also, whenever you want to measure time in that way, in minutes or seconds, it is a complicated process to break down the basic operation that a computer uses. So, and mostly it is in nanoseconds and microseconds, so it is always better to measure it in the number of operations required. Now, the next thing we will consider is whenever we are talking about time complexity, you will have basically three types of time complexity. The types can be described as follows. So one is best case, average case, and worst case. Okay, now what do you mean by best case, average case, and worst case? So best case time complexity, so let's begin with worst case. Actually, worst case will be the greatest amount of time required by an algorithm to solve a problem of given size. So whatever is the maximum amount of time required, that is the worst case complexity. Now the next will be average case. So another complexity is average case. What is that? It is a complexity where the average amount of time required for an algorithm to solve a problem of given size. And the last is the best case. So you can easily guess the definition for this. It is the least amount of time or the minimum amount of time required by an algorithm to solve a problem of the given size. So this is the different or the various types of complexities. Now based on this, in our syllabus we don't have this in much detail. You will be studying it in a later subject, but for now you just have to remember a few complexities. The first and foremost is the finding maximum of n elements. So basically, whenever we are finding the maximum of n elements, you compare or you perform n number of comparisons. Okay, you first assign the first value to the variable max, and then you perform n number of comparisons. So the time complexity is usually theta of n. Okay, this is a symbol that we use for showing the time complexity. So we use theta, big O, and omega. These are the various symbols. Apart from that, linear search requires big O of n comparisons. That is, for linear search also we compare it n times. And apart from that, the average case complexity of linear search is theta of n. Also for binary search, the comparisons that it requires is theta of log n, because we are dividing the array into two and then we are trying to find. So whenever we are performing division on an array, then it comes to log n comparisons. And so if you compare, log n will be lesser than n. So binary search is a more efficient algorithm than efficient than linear search. And also the next one is for insertion sort and bubble sort. Insertion sort and bubble sort. Where the complexity, worst case complexity is theta of n square. Why is it n square? Because suppose if the smallest element is at the end, then you have to move it from the last position to the first position, which requires a lot of comparisons. So that is the reason it is n square. The detailed explanations will be studied later, but for now you just can remember these values. Now, apart from this, we have a few terminologies to be remembered. So these are the same thing. The time complexity is expressed in terms of the number of operations. The operation used to measure time complexity can be the comparison, addition, multiplication. And apart from that, the number of operations required, we don't measure it in actual computer time, but we measure the operations. Also, it is quite complicated to break down all the operations. And the worst case definition, by the worst case performance, it is the largest number of operations. Similarly, I have already given you the definition for average case and best case. Now, there is a commonly used terminology that we will study for the complexity of the algorithms. So commonly, when we are saying the complexity of algorithms, it can, the minimum complexity for any algorithm is theta of 1. Theta of 1 means that it requires only one operation. So this is known as the constant complexity. Okay, this is the minimum. Constant complexity is for a sequence of terms. Suppose if we are comparing it, then no matter what n is, we perform only one comparison, so that is constant complexity. And then this log n, which we have already seen for binary search, this is known as logarithmic complexity. Many important algorithms even have logarithmic complexity. So usually the complexity is shown in this way, that theta of 1 is less than theta of log n, which is less than theta of n. And this continues. So each this table has been created in such a way that the least complexity is on the top of the table, while the greatest complexity or the worst complexity is at the bottom. And apart from that, we have linear complexity, which we have already seen for linear search and also for finding the maximum elements. Then we have linear arithmetic complexity. That is, we multiply the n with log n. Okay, and then polynomial and exponential complexity are usually the worst case complexities. Whenever these three types of complexities are for any algorithm, then those algorithms are not really considered as efficient. Next, there are types of problem that we study. So a problem that is solvable using an algorithm with polynomial worst case complexity. So suppose if a problem is solved by polynomial worst case complexity, which is n power b, where b is some variable, then in that case, that problem is called as tractable problem. Okay, so the problem is known as tractable problem because the expectation is that the algorithm will produce the solution. So algorithm will produce solution to the problem in some reasonable time, So that is why it is known as tractable. Okay, And however, if the problem is bigger, that is the problems that cannot be solved using an algorithm with worst case polynomial time complexity, then such kind of problems are known as intractable. Okay, so the problems which can be solved by using the polynomial worst case complexity are tractable, which cannot be solved are intractable. Basically, the tractable problem are easy to solve or easy to deal with. Okay, so that is, they can be easily solved in the amount of time given, while the intractable problem are not always solvable, and even for small input values, they take the worst case time. So in practice, whenever we have such kind of problems, it is more agreeable to take the algorithm which is tractable. Now, apart from this, we even have two other type of problems which are solvable and unsolvable. So some problems, like you have already seen, which is halting problem, are unsolvable problem. That is, there is no such algorithm which can solve it. No algorithm exists for solving them. Such problems are called as unsolvable, while solvable problems are basically which can be solved using an algorithm. Now this concludes the topic complexity of algorithm. The next topic is integers and division. Now the integers and division, it is a part of your computer science topic which is known as number theory. That is, in this we will see the modular arithmetic theorems and a few formulas to be remembered, which can be used in discrete mathematics. So in this topic, we will deal with the divisibility problem, which is whenever we divide a number by a positive integer, whenever a division of an integer by a positive integer, it may be negative also, the integer which we are dividing, it may be negative also, then it produces a quotient and a remainder. And working with the remainder leads to modular arithmetic. So whenever we are talking about remainders, it leads to a topic which is modular arithmetic, which is a very important topic in computer science. Modular arithmetic, it is a very important topic in computer science, and there are many applications of this topic. So we will study that. So we review the basic concepts of number theory, divisibility, greatest common divisor, and modular arithmetic are covered, along with which we also see a few applications. So first, division. When one integer is divided by a second non-zero integer, then the quotient may or may not be an integer. For example, if I'm saying 12 divided by 3, it will be equal to 4, which is an integer. But if in case 11 is divided by 4, it will be equivalent to 2.75, which is not an integer. So we, with respect to this, our first definition is, if a and b are integers, so we take two numbers a and b which are integers with a not equal to 0, then we say that a divides b if there is an integer c such that b is equal to ac. So when a divides b, we say that a is a factor of b and b is a multiple of a, and the notation is a divides b denotes that a divides b. So a line b denotes the notation a divides b, while a does not divide b is denoted in this way. Okay, so let me explain this. So over here, suppose we have two integers a comma b, and also a is not equal to 0. Whenever we say a divides b, so we use a straight line to show the notation a divides b. When we get another integer c, which is which gives us the equation B is equal to AC. So whenever we multiply A with C, it should give us B. Then only we can say that A divides B. And also, whenever A divides B, A is known as a factor. A is the factor, while B is the multiple of A. And the notation is A divides B. And for A does not divide, it is a line. We cross it, A does not divide B. So this is in this way. A divides B. And this is A does not divide B. Now let's see an example with respect to same. Also, we can express this by using quantifiers. That is, we can use existential quantifier. There exists some C where AC is equal to B. And where the domain, where the universe of discourse or our domain is the set of integers Z. Now, let's take an example. Determine whether 3 divides 7 and second, so this is the first bit, the second bit is 3 divides 12. Now for this, let's take the first one, 3 divides 7. Can we write 7 by 3 and can we get an integer whenever we are dividing 7 by 3? No, it will give us 2.33 and so on, which is not an integer. It is not an integer. In this case, if we are not getting an integer, there is no such integer which can give us B is equal to AC. So for that reason, we have to say that 3 does not divide 7. Therefore, 3 does not divide 7. Now, what about 3 divides 12? So for 3 divides 12, check whether 12 is divisible by 3 and whether it is giving us an integer. Yes, 4. And we can write 12 as, so if you remember, this is A divides B. So B value is 12. 12 is equal to 3 into 4. So clearly there is an integer 4 which can be written as B is equal to AC. So in this case, 3 divides 12 is correct. Now let's see some of the basic properties of divisibility. Of integers. So let A comma B comma C be integers, then we can say that if A divides B and A divides C, then A divides B plus C. Also, if A divides B, then A divides BC for all integers. Also, if A divides B and B divides C, then A divides C. Let's take an example to understand this. So if we are saying 3 divides 12 and 3 divides 6. Okay, so if 3 divides 12, the answer is 4. When 3 divides 6, the answer is 2. Then definitely we can see that 3 divides 18. Okay, 3 divides 18 will give us 6. For this, if A divides B, so if 3 divides 12, then if C is 2, then 3 also divides 24, 3 also divides 36. Whenever you are multiplying the variable B with any integer, then even that will be divisible by A. Similarly, if for the last one, if 3 divides 12 and 12 divides 36, then 3 will also divide 36. Okay, it will give us the result 18. So these are the few properties of divisibility of integers. Now the next thing is the division algorithm. So the same thing has been shown in this. So the next topic is the division algorithm. What do you mean by the division algorithm? Suppose if we have an integer a, a be an integer, and d is a positive integer, so z plus, then there are unique integers q and r. Q and r are unique integers. Also, r lies between 0 and d. R can be equal to 0 but less than d. Then we can write a is equal to dq plus r. So basically this is the dividend is equal to divisor into quotient plus remainder. Okay, a over here, a is the dividend. D is the divisor. Q is the quotient. And R is the remainder. This is something that we have already studied and it is the basic of mathematics. Apart from this, also, one more thing is Q, the quotient is equal to A dividing D, while remainder is equal to A mod D. Now let's take an example for the same. What are the quotient and the remainder? Example, what are the quotient and remainder when 101 is divided by 11? So when we want to find the quotient, then it means we have to take 101 by 11, which will give us 9. Okay, 11 times gives us 99. So the quotient is 9, while the remainder will be 101 mod 11. So the remainder is 2. And also we can represent 101 as, to verify our answer, 11 into 9 plus 2, which is basically 101 again. So this is the answer. Also, one more thing to be remembered is, you have seen already that remainder cannot be negative. That is, remainder will always be greater than or equal to 0 and less than the divisor. Now, what are the quotient and the remainder when minus 11, we have to find quotient and remainder when minus 11 is divided by 3. So, quotient will be minus 11 divided by 3, which is equivalent to minus 4, while r is equal to minus 11 mod 3, which is equal to 1. Let's verify it. Dividend is equal to divisor into quotient plus remainder. So minus 12 plus 1 is equal to minus 11. Next, the next topic is the one I said which was important is modular arithmetic. So basically, modular arithmetic is when two integers have the same remainder. Two integers have the same remainder. when they are divided by positive integer m. Positive integer m. So that is, if a and b are integers, then, and also m is a positive integer, then a is congruent to b modulo m if m divides a minus b. So the notation is written as a is congruent to b mod m. What does it simply mean? That they have the same remainder when they are divided by some integer, positive integer m. And also, if they are not congruent, it is denoted in this way: a is not congruent to b mod m. Now, the next thing is, we are taking an example for the same. Determine whether 17 is congruent to 5 modulo 6. Check whether 17 is congruent to 5 modulo 6, and also whether 24 and 14 are congruent to modulo 6. Now, so for the first one, 17 being congruent to 5 modulo 6, because 6 divides, if we are talking about 17 divided by 6, whenever 17 is divided by 6, we will get the remainder 5. While also, whenever 5 is divided by 6, even then the remainder is 5. We can even verify this in this way: 17 minus 5 is equivalent to 12. And 12 is divisible by 6. So what was the formula that I have said earlier? If a minus b is divisible by m, then a and b are congruent. So 17 minus 5 is equal to 12 and it is divisible by 6. So 17 can be written as 17 is congruent to 5 mod 6. Now, what about the next one? 24 and 14. So for 24 and 14, 24 minus 14 is equivalent to 10, and 10, it is not divisible by 6. So 24 is not congruent to 14 mod 6. So this concludes the topic, integers and division. The applications can be referred as hashing function, cryptography, and pseudorandom numbers. Those are the applications of this topic which can be referred. Thank you.